Ladies and gentlemen, very, very good evening. At the very outset, I profusely thank the Manthan and the amazing audience that makes Manthan what it is now and what it will be in future for coming to this place. And then it really calls for courage and honesty to stand in front of Manthanites. Not everyone can come here and then talk. That is the quality of Manthan and its community we have in Hyderabad. And I thank Sri Madhavarav sir and Sri Ajay Gandhi and Vikramji for nudging me towards this days and then share my story with you. Friends, many of you, like while having tea also, you have asked me the question, why is that you have come to this department? That is the crux of the story. And that is the point on which I am gonna spend quite a few minutes. And I have a PowerPoint presentation, I think all may not be able to see, but there's nothing much in that PowerPoint presentation, but that will give me, you know, reference points on which I have to talk. And then I have quite a few photographs so that you can see. But otherwise, it's not a lecture, it's not a proper PowerPoint presentation which happens in all the, you know, boardrooms. Friends, I'll just start with a image of three girls. So just go to, yeah. So this is the image of three girls. So, and they are in my home. And then you have Dr. B.R. Ambedkar in the background. So that is my drawing room. And I have called, my wife and I, both of us, we called these three girls from the home because their father waylaid their mother and decapitated her. So killed her, so separated trunk from the body in a place called Maminpet in Vikarabad. The reason is that lady failed to produce a boy. First delivery girl, second delivery girl, third delivery girl, and then he developed grudge against that lady, and somehow he wanted to finish her off. So he wanted to marry again, but that lady, she did not give in, and then she took him to court, and that fellow also did not give in, and finally the matter is sub judice. And in the meantime, he wanted to do away with not only that lady but these three children. But only one thing that saved the three children is Social Welfare Residential Education Institution. But for that institution, all these three girls would have been killed. So we have students like this in our institution. Go to the next one. See this girl. This girl is Renuka. She is a student of Addagudur Social Welfare Residential School. I'll just read out the marks that the girl got in 10th grade. 527 out of 600. 527 out of 600. She studied in English medium. And intermediate, 877 out of 1000. I don't know about you. Many of you, like 90% of you may have got, you know, above 90%, but I got only 389 out of 600 in my 10th grade. And I studied in Telugu medium. But this girl, she got 527 marks out of 600. But the tragedy here is, this girl graduates from the same residential school in Addagudur and lands in a hospital in Bovenpally only to work as scavenger. she was earning just 3,000 rupees. And today morning, you have that letter? Yes. Fast. Yeah. Yeah, thank you. Today morning, I got a WhatsApp message from one of our superintendents. This guy writes, this is about another girl anyway, for various reasons, I'm not able to show her video. So, sir, the girl in this video is a Swero student. She has completed her intermediate in first division. While I was journeying from Nirmal, of Nirmal district, erstwhile Adilabad, on 31-10-2017, to attend a superannuation function at Left Pochampad, and meanwhile the journey at a RTC bus station at Jennaram in Mancherial district, a girl by name Padma, working as scavenger. Really, tears came out from my eyes, and she was an intelligent girl in college days. I asked the girl why she had chosen the field, and when you have so many golden opportunities. The girl answered with tears in her eyes that her father forced for early marriage, and now she is having a small kid, and her husband also not sharing the responsibilities. So in those unavoidable circumstances, she is working as scavenger to get her livelihood. This is the tragedy of Padma, and she is a first division student in intermediate. So this is Renuka, and one of our Sveros. Sveros are none other than the students of all welfare residential schools and hostels. That's the new identity that we gave them. So one of them, he went to the hospital for a medical consultation. Suddenly he found the girl in school uniform working as a scavenger. And then he gave us a message, and then suddenly we rescued the girl. Now she is a first division student in St. Anne's Degree College in Medipatnam. So that is about Renuka. Then third, next. So this is a suicide note of a girl called Maggidi Jansi. She lost her father when she was a child, and mother was working as an agricultural laborer in Warangal district, Parvatagiri. And last month she committed suicide. And the suicide note, anyway, I won't read it. But the essence of the note is, Amma is mother. So Amma, you have been working very hard to make both the ends meet. And I am down with a small kidney pain, which no doctor is able to cure. And since you are running out of money, and since I have no choice, so I am leaving this world, at least your burden on your shoulders will come down. Take care of brother. That's what she says. So there is a problem in our society. Some people are privileged, they are in the orbit of privileges, and some people are less privileged, and then they're always in the orbit of less privileged. And less privileged people, very rarely they get the escape velocity to get into the orbit of privilege. What we are trying to do with the help of government in social welfare residential schools is to give that escape velocity so that the less privileged people can get into the privileged section. So this is the story of Maggidi Jansi. Like that we have, yeah, next. So this is a lady by name Premamma. She's an incredible lady. So she was a child laborer in her childhood, and today she is a retired teacher. I will tell her story a little later. I came to know her story when she was 75 years old. So I will tell her story a little later. Okay, next. This is me. You can see me in uniform, full of medals. And see, for your information, I have volunteered to come into this position. See, many people, for those retired senior bureaucrats here, so many people generally do not want to come to social welfare. They don't want to come to tribal welfare because they are not glamorous positions. See, my medals, you can see, I am a President's Police Medal for Gallantry Award winner. probably in India there are about probably 1500 to 2000 or maybe 3000 4000 people in since independence you have gallantry medal award winners. Very rarely you get, for the exceptional act of bravery you get gallantry medal. I got Indian police medal for meritorious service. I got internal security medal. I got independence day medal. I got United Nations police medal. These are the medals which every police officer would dream to have, these kind of medals. Yet I wanted to come to social welfare residential schools and I volunteered to be here. I'll tell you why. Okay. See, before I come to the points that I have written in the slide, one day my mom called me. That's why I'm always scared of Jan 1st. My mom, there is a festival in our village. So in 2010, I think, my mom called me to, you know, come to village and then spend some time and so that, you know, she can talk to me. So every time I go to my village, I do not stay for more than 20 minutes, or more than 1 hour or 2 hours. But this time my mom ensured that I stay there for about 5 to 6 hours. She took me to each and every household in my neighborhood. So after seeing all those things, and then we came back, and then she asked me only one question. Are you proud that you are an IPS officer? Because all my neighbors are either agricultural laborers or stone cutters who are eking out their livelihood by getting about 150 to 200 rupees per day. And by evening, most of the men, they go to local toddy shops. 99% of the time it is adulterated, chloral hydrous and then digipam mixed, because there are no toddy trees in our locality. So they are addicted to these toddy for generations. So these people get drunk and then they beat wives. And if there are girls in that locality, so naturally they would get married off. It goes without saying. And there are so many child marriages. My mom asked me only one question. Should I feel proud that my son is an IPS officer? Or should I feel sad that in spite of being an IPS officer, my son is not able to do anything for the people in the neighborhood? I felt really very sad. What is this? So is it enough to have IPS on my shoulders and then have two Kalashnikovs, two PSOs saving me, safeguarding me all the time, and then have a nice bungalow that is given by the government and have a nice car, again given by government, and then is it enough? Is it enough to live in my own bubble, a cozy and then comfortable bubble, or should I go beyond that bubble? Should I break that bubble and then touch the real world? Was the question that my mom posed to me. So this is what really, created churning in my, the mind. So then I came back. Then Telangana agitation started by then, 2009, November 29th was the second phase of Telangana agitation. So I was airlifted practically when not airlifted. I was forced to leave the posting in which I was working, and then I was asked to report in Usman University. And then I could see most of the students who were pelting stones on police. So morning we used to pelt stones, they used to pelt stones at us, and then we used to fire tear gas shells. Afternoon everything would be over. By evening I would go to Arts College campus and then start taking chai with those students who used to pelt stones on us, because that's a peace time. Again morning, again they would come back and then start pelting stones from Krishnaveni Hartzell or Arts College, and then we fire tear gas shells. By evening again we go with white flags. They come with white flags, sir, em chestunnaru sir, what is it happening sir, anni raalu enduku chestunnaru. We will ask, then bolo bole sir, itna tear gas shells kyon pek rahe sir hamare upar karte. So, but when I spoke to the children there, absolute poverty. There was no money, pocket money, nothing. To have even shorts, they used to cut their jean pants and then used to have. No chappal. Some of the students, they used to live in Manikeshwar with much more destitution. So that was the condition. So finally, I decided that I should hang my boots and then go for study leave and then see what best we can do to these children. So then I worked really very hard, and then I worked really hard, and then I landed in Harvard University. And in that year, I was the only civil servant to be selected for Harvard University in the entire country. So I went as a Mason Fellow, then I completed my graduation, and then I came back. Then I, as Madhurav sir just now said, so I went to my DG, but DG was not very keen to leave me. So I somehow convinced him, and then I finally went to our chief minister in those days, Mr. Kiran Kumar Reddy. So I requested him. First, he was confused. How come a police officer is willing to work in social welfare where the people who belong to that community itself, they are not willing to go? And this fellow wants to go and then work there. And then why is that you are going? Are you mad or what? That's what he said. He has seen many police officers who can, sir, please give me that DIG, this DIG, or this commissioner, that commissioner. But here is a guy who is asking for a lowly social welfare, small, where nobody wants to go. Even if they go, the average tenure will be only 3 months to 6 months. So that is the kind of questions he asked. Finally, I said, sir, I am from these institutions. Enough is enough. 17 years I have worked for police, hard policing I have done. Please give me an opportunity to serve those people who have not got the opportunity like me to become an IPS officer. Then I went, finally gave an order. So there are three, four important reasons what made me to ask like that. First is, I was searching for a deeper purpose. Ladies and gentlemen, all of us are going to leave this world. It's not very comfortable to talk about leaving the world, but it is a fact. We are going to leave this world. Some will leave early, some will leave later, but all of us will leave this world. But as you grow in your life, you search for purpose. I'm being very honest with you. You search for purpose. You search for legacy. What happens? Why am I here? And then should I do something for others as well? Or is it the purpose for which I am here? So these are the things, these questions started, pinching me, poking me, making me sleepless all through the time. So I thought I should really start a fresh journey to search for my purpose. So that is one of the reasons. And the second reason is diverse exposure. So all through 17 years I have been working in police department, I wanted to have a different exposure, which normally any employee would like to have. Then third is wider and deeper impact. In policing, you can have a better impact and you can make the entire world safe, yet, but you cannot make 100 people as employees, or 1,000 people are employees, or you cannot lift the people out of poverty, who are facing the deprivation in the village. So I thought I should have a wider and deeper impact, paying back to the society and getting the root causes of the problem. So I thought I should try this as well. So this is one of the reasons why I wanted to change career for a while. Okay, next please. So, but see the reaction. This is very interesting. The day I reported on, I still remember July 4th, 2012, there was strike. The reasons for the strike are very interesting to see, friends. First, why an IPS officer should come to the job as an IAS officer? This is not the question which is asked by IAS officers. This is the question asked by our teachers. When I say teachers, the teacher union people. Then second, cop in the classrooms? No way. Our classrooms will get desecrated. What kind of image will our schools have if a police officer comes to the classrooms? So no way, we should not have a cop in the classroom. Third, this fellow will torture us in the name of discipline, in the name of punctuality. This is what our union friends told me. Now they are very good friends of mine. Otherwise, I would not have stayed in this society for the last, this is my sixth year. So this guy is going to torture us in the name of discipline. So we don't want him. Then fourth, then the moment you enter the classroom with guns, then you are gone. So you are going to threaten us, you are going to do this, you are going to do that. But one girl by name Radha from Anantapur, this girl gave me the courage, my dear friends. So one day I went to Anantapur, the moment I joined, so I thought I should not stay in the office and then start signing the files. I hate signing the files. So I'm sitting in the office and then signing the files. So I thought I should leave this place, and I took permission from my wife that I'm not going to come back to home for 6 months. Please bear with me. So if at all, and then I asked my PS to send all the files by vehicle, by air or by rail or whatever road. So send the files wherever I am. So I'll sign in the guest houses, I'll in the train compartments, but I'm not going to come to office. So I went to a place called Kurugunta in Anantapur. So when I entered the classroom, wherever I go, I have a pistol with me. So one girl, she gathered courage when I was talking to the students. She was in ninth grade. Her name is Radha Priya. So this girl gathered courage and then said, sir, I want to ask a question. So what is the question? Sir, can I touch your gun? can I touch your gun? So then I removed the magazine because of, you know, pistol loaded gun. So I removed the magazine and said, okay, touch it. And she felt very happy. So I could see in her eyes that she felt really empowered. See, the deprived sections, marginalized sections, suppressed sections in the society who have been kept away from power of knowledge, then power of authority, whatever. So the moment she touched it, I could see the, you know, brightness in her eyes. Then another time, after 3 months, one girl by name Ganga Priya, she came from Vishakhapatnam. Then she came to my office when I was sitting in my chamber. Then, sir, I want to take a photograph. Then I asked, come, let's pose for a photograph. Then she said, no, sir, not like that. You have to get up. I want to sit on this chair and then have a photograph. Her name is Ganga Talli. She's from Center of Excellence, Vishakhapatnam. Parents are working as, father is working as a, tractor driver. So Ganga Talli wants to become a secretary. Sir, I want to grab your seat. This is the confidence the children had. But when I go to schools, the danger I faced was every time the principal introduces only class first and class second, as if all others are not good. Sir, this is class first, this is class second. Then what happened to those 38 people? What will happen to them? So that was the question always used to pinch me. So these are the things that I had faced in 2012 on June, July 7th, when I took over charge. But now this has been toned down a lot. That is the reason why I'm here for the last, 6 years. Yeah, next. So then I launched my expedition. You can see the gun here. So wherever I go, because this is a part of my body. So I don't, and then our children are extremely happy about seeing their secretary with gun. So they're very happy. And then I entered as many classrooms as possible, probably in the last 6 years, in the last 5 years, I have visited about 300 schools in Andhra and Telangana put together. 300 schools, my dear friends. There are about 450 schools now, as of now. So I have visited about 300 schools, and then I don't know how many thousands of children I have spoken to. So then I went to classrooms, and then I went to the principals, and then started speaking to them, and then to start understanding the dynamics of education system, particularly in public schools. Next. Yeah, so this is me, sitting in the classrooms. Whenever, any secretary goes, generally they get confined to the offices and then comforts. But I used to make a point that I must sit in the classrooms. And this is what, I used to do. And then what I discovered, another important thing in the classrooms was, the children have great energies, but the classroom environment is such that it suppresses all that energies. They are treated like slaves, and teacher knows everything and the student doesn't know anything. This is the gundagiri of classrooms. This is what happens in most of the classrooms, including universities. And I don't know universities whether students attend the classrooms or not. That's a different debate altogether. But this is what happens in the classrooms in our country. And Telangana is not an exception. Okay, next please. See, my diagnosis after 6 months of continuous field visit was, one is there is no security of tenure for OSD, head of the department. So first thing is, in government or any organization for that matter, to make a change, you need at least a stable tenure of minimum 3 years. That is a convention. But here the average tenure in the last 30 years was 3 months. We have had heads of the department who had the tenure of 15 days. Within 15 days, what do you understand of the system? Then how will you touch the lives of the people? And how do you address the concerns of stakeholders? Nothing. So 15 days, and then I don't know how people were being posted, and then how people were trying to come out, and then some people were trying to use it as a launch pad, and some people, parents were not good. So go to social welfare residential school, kuch kaam nahi hai, 11 baje aa jao, 3 baje chale jao, koi bhi nahi puchega. So this thing was there, and it is part of our folklore. Whenever you go, the attender and all these people will tell you, sir, saab, aur ye aate the, wo aate the, chale jaate the. That is what used to happen earlier times. The second thing was pervasive innocence. Children do not know anything. children were not told about the many things that are happening around them. So there was pervasive innocence and then apathy. The third is, only 8% of our schools had furniture. Believe me, 8% of the schools. And then particularly girls, they didn't have a separate dormitory at all. Classroom and dormitory is one and same. And no furniture. And imagine the girls sitting for a longer time, that too after adolescence, is really, really a tragic scene in the classroom. So that was there in those days. And absolutely trust deficit. Absolute trust deficit. So one day I went to a village called Pattikonda, their social welfare residence school. And the moment the watchman, he saw the car of some official, he didn't know that I was secretary. There were 7 to 10 people who were being chased continuously. And some people fell down and they were in lungis and they didn't have chappal. So they fell down. Then he opened the door because he thought there is a government vehicle written on that in my car, on my car. So he allowed me inside. When I saw inside, I was really shocked. There were pigs, there were dogs, and there was everything that was what you can call as a mayhem. So children were just doing what they wanted, and then all the pigs and dogs, and they were in the company of dogs and pigs. And then I asked the watchman, do you think that these parents, they asked them, who are these people whom you are chasing? Sir, they are parents. So I asked the question, the principal and the watchman was, do you think that these dogs and pigs are more important and more privileged to be in the school than the parents who are standing outside? Then I called all the parents and asked them to sit in front of me in the principal's chamber. Then they had tears in their eyes. Sir, this is how these people treat us in the villages. And then same thing happens in the schools which are exclusively meant to empower us. And see the mindset of the principal. So these people always come, sir, they do this, they ask that, they ask that, and then after that. So it's the same old story I was telling. So there was absolutely trust deficit among all the stakeholders. Then students had wonderful potential, but they didn't know what to do. Then there was feeble monitoring system. I was not surprised. And then zero exposure to the outside world because they're all closed entities. Okay, next please. See, this is one thing which is the central theme in my talk today. See, there was a saturation of stereotyping in this country. There will be, if we don't wake up. See, when you type in Google and type Dalits, see what images you get. Now you can see the pattern of images. You have people, then you have a lot of heaps of refuge, urban garbage, and then you have children, torn cloths playing, and then you have a lot of old people with so much of fear and then pain in their faces. So these are the images you get in this country when you type Dalits in Google. Type other communities, then you find a different type of images. So we were really worried about the stereotyping of children. Now in Telugu, there is something called Badugu, backward. Then Balahina, weak. Nimna means always should be under in the lowest possible rank. So this negative stereotyping was pervasive. You go to any place, the people, oh, papam. So oh, poor Dalit boy, poor SC boy, poor SC girl. All that poor, there's a flooding of sympathy, which was doing a lot of harm to these children. We were really worried about the saturation aspect of this stereotyping. Then you go to I went to a place called Cherial. Then I asked the boys, what is the question that scares you most? I asked 10 to 15 people. One of the most important and then scary questions for the children is, where do you live in the village? If the guy who is asking the question is from the same village, that fellow is gone for that day. Because he will know that he is already living in the fringes of the village. Then second thing is, what about your parents? These two questions are enough, because now people are smart enough to ask, not to ask the question, which caste do you belong to? There are many other ways of asking the identity. So they say, which village are you from? And what do your father do? These are the two questions they scare most of the children. They don't want these things to be asked. So that's the reason why we wanted to change this stereotyping of all our children. So yeah, go to the next point. Then we decided in a combined meeting of all the alumni, we decided that we must not use the word called Dalit in our schools. Then we must use the word called SWERO. SW stands for state welfare, and AERO is something synonymous with air and sky. So whoever, suppose I am Pallavi, I would call myself as Pallavi SWERO. If I am Praveen Kumar, I would call myself as Praveen SWERO. So SWERO was a neutral identity which is a reflection, is a symbol of my aspirations. See, identity must always inspire you to do something different and something great. Identity must not remind you of the painful images. The moment you say Dalit, then you make me remember all those painful images. I'm not saying that there is no discrimination in the country. There is much more discrimination in this country. There is fascist kind of tendency in this country. But when you force me to call that word, then you are making me remember that, look, I have been like this and then I'm broken because Dalit is broken, I'm suppressed. So instead, can I call myself as a different person and then start looking at the future where I might have some greater opportunity, or looking at my own potential and then I can tap that potential and then do something different? This is what we wanted to do. So that is the reason why we started SWERO, and today it is one of the fastest growing networks in, you know, Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. So now see the symbol. We wanted to have a very different symbol. Now, those of you who are very good at mathematics, so you know the symbol of infinity is incomplete 8. Now, here there is incomplete 8 and then the convergence of a human being and incomplete 8. Because we wanted to tell our children that there shall not be any limit on your imagination, whether it is escaping from poverty or doing great things. So, we thought, this is the symbol. So, and then we finalized on this symbol. This is how we have created the SWERO ideology. Next, please. And friends, the SWERO ideology has been crystallized to 10 commandments. This is the crystallized version of our, our ideology. The first commandment, we have 10 commandments. All these 2 lakh children, they recite these 10 commandments. The first commandment is, I am not inferior to anyone. The second commandment is, I shall be the leader wherever I am. Third commandment is, I shall do what I love and be different. The fourth commandment is, I shall always think big and aim high. The fifth one is, I shall be honest, hardworking and punctual. The sixth commandment is, I shall never blame others for my failures. The seventh one is, I shall neither beg nor cheat. Eighth one is, I shall repay what I borrow. Ninth one is, I shall never fear the unknown. And the tenth one is, I shall never give up. These are the 10 commandments, which all our students across Andhra and Telangana, all residential schools, they recite these commandments morning and evening. So this identity coupled with principles for success are creating ripples in the minds of the students, and then they are galvanizing the children to look upwards, not to get linked with their painful past. Yeah, next please. But to prove this, we are different. To prove this, we wanted to do something. To prove this, we are not what you think. To prove this, we are not broken. We are capable like anybody else. We wanted to do some proof of, we wanted to prove some concept. We wanted heroes. So to search for heroes, I cannot go to Bollywood and find one Amitabh Bachchan. I cannot go to Hollywood and Tollywood and then I can have a Janelia D'Souza or Anushka Shetty or Kajal Agarwal or Mahesh Babu or Prabhas. So we didn't want to go to Bollywoods, Hollywoods and Collywoods and Tollywoods. We thought we should find the heroes in SWERO Wood. So that's how, so we were desperately searching for heroes, and then we wanted the heroes to be from our own ecosystem. That is very important. That's how the children, you know, get inspired. If I can't take Amitabh Bachchan and then put him in our school, see, look at Amitabh Bachchan, look at XYZ and then get inspired from them. No, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen that way. So we wanted to create heroes. If there are no heroes, then create the heroes who are alive. And who is your neighbor? Then Bhuvanagiri Rock. So those of you who know Warangal route. So Bhuvanagiri Rock came to our rescue, my dear friends. That gave answers to all our questions. We had a great principal secretary called Mr. Raymond Peter. So he knew someone called Shekhar Babu who had scaled Mount Everest. in 2007. But Shekhar Babu was looking for opportunities to make many more Shekhar Babus. So one day Shekhar Babu came to me, "Sir, give me an opportunity." Then I said, "Shekhar, what can you do?" "Sir, I am from government school. I was LCC cadet, and then I wanted to, I climbed Mount Everest, and then I wanted to help those people who are willing to scale Mount Everest." So we called Shekhar Babu, and then we said, "Look at our children. They are so emaciated and all. So will they be able to scale Mount Everest?" "Sir, I may not be able to say whether they'll scale Mount Everest or not, but for sure I will try with Bongir Rock." Then we went to Bongir Rock. We selected the first 110 parents we contacted. None of them were willing. 300 parents we contacted. None of them were willing. They said, "Will you do the same thing with your children? Bongir Rock is 600 meters high. So if they fall down from the rock, then you are gone. So send your children, not our children." This is the question most of the parents ask. But with great difficulty, we used to have a very interesting physical director, Mr. Mannan. So he went and then finally convinced 110 parents who could send their children to Bongir Rock. And to our misfortune, on the second day itself, one girl called Bharati, she fell down. She fell down, and then there was a huge injury, and then she was admitted in Bongir Government Hospital. And four sutures, doctor had applied four sutures, and then she was lying on the bed. And then I went to see her because it is my responsibility, because I have called them. Then Bharati started crying. Then I asked Bharati, "Why are you crying?" "Sir, I am not crying because I have pain in my head. I am not crying because I have sutures. I am crying because I am losing out a chance to go to Mount Everest." And Bharati is a daughter of agricultural laborers in Kadapa district, Tondur. So this is the power of these girls from these sections. This is the, when I say these sections, all those marginalized sections, irrespective of the caste and creed. So we rarely touch those powers. We rarely touch that potential. So Bongir Rock helped us to discover that potential among those kids. And then after that, anyway, we finalized, we could find 20 people who are, the outstanding people. So this is the first batch of explorers. This is the first batch of pathfinders. These are the people who sacrificed all that. These are the young children, boys and girls. There, this is only a boy's photograph. These are the young children who sacrificed whatever they had. So they believed that, yes, with these 10 commandments, we can scale any height in this world. And these are the people who successfully completed, the Bongir expedition. Okay, next please. And later, you can see, I'm putting a fast forward button here. So we went to, Darjeeling, then we had Himalayan Mountaineering Institute and then rock climbing. And after that, then we had sent these children to another place, and then minus 35 degrees centigrade. At least 5 people survived in that minus 35 degrees centigrade. Then we came back, and then we asked the parents, and then parents, so we told them, okay, the final journey is Mount Everest. Then Mount Everest, if they survive, that's great. Then if they don't survive, we are not going to bring their bodies back. And said, "Are you still willing?" Because the GO was issued on my name. Because Secretary of AP Social Welfare Residential Institutions has asked for this expedition. So we are sanctioning 68 lakhs. Before that, there was a lot of problem. Like people said, with these 68 lakhs, you can build 10 schools. With these 68 lakhs, you can build 20 schools. Or 20 furniture, 20 benches, all that discussion had happened. I still said, two people, if they can successfully scale the highest peak on this earth, they are going to be the game changers in the mindsets of people of this country, not only the state of Andhra Pradesh, entire country. So that is what I have argued. But finally, we had some good bureaucrats, the same secretariat which is across the road. So they could, convince the chief minister, and then finally we got the order. Then when we called the parents, you know what they said? And then I took them to Nampally railway station where they were boarding AP Express at about 6 a.m. in the morning. Then I asked them, Devdas and Kondal Rao, once again I'm asking, this is a huge risky expedition. Even if they come back, if there is a frostbite, they might lose their limbs. Are you still willing? You know what they said? Sir, these children are not our children. They are your children. These children are going with the flag of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, who has sacrificed all his life. So these are the, as long as he is there with them, nothing is going to happen. So they left. Then finally came back and then we kept our fingers crossed. So they went to Nepal. Then all that training was over. They went to Nepal on April 18th, 2014. I was in Bapatla. I was, you know, inspecting some schools. I got a call from Raymond Peter, sir. Have you seen the news? Then I didn't see the news. So I didn't watch the news. So then I asked him, what happened? So what happened, sir? Then he told, sir, Praveen, Atarol ke mar gaya yaar, bula apna bachchon ko. अठारह लोग मर गए तो कुछ प्रॉब्लम हो गए तो हम दोनों को ख़त्म कर देंगे लोग. देन आई केम बैक एंड देन आई टॉक टू शेखर बाबू एंड देन आस्क द शेखर शेखर बाबू टू गिव हैंड ओवर फोन टू पूर्णा. देन व्हेन आई स्पोक टू पूर्णा, यू नो व्हाट शी सेड, पूर्णा अठारह लोगों का मौत हो गया. एनी वे यू आर गोइंग इन, यू नो यू आर गोइंग फ्रॉम ए मच रिस्कियर साइड, दैट इज नॉर्थ कॉलम. एवरेस्ट कैन बी अप्रोच्ड फ्रॉम टू साइड्स एंड वन इज साउथ एंड सेकेंड इज नॉर्थ. You are going from a much more tougher one. So why don't you drop the idea and then come back? You have done enough in your life. You know what she said? Sir, this world, both Anand and Purna, but particularly Purna was emphatic. This girl told me, sir, this world has discriminated us for the last so many years. And then even today, I am in the forest. My home is still in the forest. Even today, their home in the forest. And then to buy one soap box, I have, my father has to go for 7 kilometers and then buy it. And this world has discriminated that you are good for nothing. But for reservations, you cannot do anything. And you can't do anything. So this kind of stereotyping the world has done to us. But we want to prove, as a girl, as a tribal girl, as a SC boy, we want to prove that given an opportunity, poorest of the poor people also can go to the highest point on this earth. And then we want to prove that. And after that, sir, we want to put Dr. B.R. Ambedkar's flag and then S.R. Shankaran's image. And then we want to, even if we die also, it doesn't matter. That girl was just 13 years old on that day. And the Anand was 16 years old. So they went ahead. They refused. Then I told the same thing to Raymond Peter. Sir, they're refusing. So what should I do? So they went ahead. Then after that, on 24th, 25th morning, 30 people started their journey for final ascent. So out of those 30 people, Purna was the youngest and she was the first to scale Mount Everest on that day. And today, she is the youngest ever female to have scaled Mount Everest in the world. So far in history, nobody has scaled Mount Everest at that age. So it is not about the, my story does not end here. I am not talking today about Purna. My emphasis is on those people who could not become Purnas. Historically, who were robbed of those opportunities to become Purnas and Anands. That is my point here. So anyway, Rahul Bose was kind enough to make a movie called Purna. And today he shared with me that Purna movie has been selected for Indian Panorama category in International Film Festival, which is likely to happen in Goa this year. So this is Rahul Bose and then our former president Pranab Mukherjee is there. So next. So he watched the entire movie along with all of us. So this is Anand. So you can see Anand is placing a photograph of S.R. Shankaran, the person, the famous IAS officer who sacrificed everything for the social welfare, you know, students and the, you know, marginalized sections in this country. And this is Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, because you know, this is the fitting tribute that we thought we can, as students, we thought we can give to these great legends of this country. So this is Anand. And, you know, Anand, this story is so pathetic. Narendra Modi ji, our Honorable Prime Minister, he gave 2 certificates to Purna and Anand and 2 shawls. Naturally, they're given by President, so they're very special. He doesn't have a secure place in his home to keep those certificates. That is the poverty in which our country is. So his mother works as Aya. So yeah, next. So now 2014 Telangana, now we are almost 60-70% through, so I have only a few slides. So after 2014, so Telangana is formed, and then our Honorable Chief Minister Sri KCRG, he called me and then said, Praveen Kumar, I heard a lot about you from various sources. Then he asked me, are you still willing to continue in this department, because in police, you are from police, so your DG or your senior officer might be interested to take you to police. Then I said, sir, give me an opportunity to, you know, complete all the projects that we have undertaken. So he said, absolutely not a problem. You have full support of the government, you know, behind you. So absolutely not a problem. Go ahead. That's what he said. So now you can see the data might not be visible. In United Andhra Pradesh, Telangana had only 296 residential education institutions. But today, Telangana has 842 residential education institutions. Now, there is a jump of 546 institutions, and only one person is responsible, that is Chief Minister. But there is another person who is also responsible. That girl is Shruti. Shruti, she is a student of Mittapalli Social Welfare Residential School. And Shruti is a student of that Mittapalli Social Welfare Residential School, and then that Mittapalli falls in the assembly constituents of former constituency of our Chief Minister. So he wanted, after he took over from as Chief Minister, he wanted to visit a couple of schools in his constituency. So he came to Mittapalli School, and then he was talking to all the students, and then he was seeing all the facilities, and then he was, you know, trying to know what is happening in education sector. And then that is the first ever visit of a Chief Minister into education sector. So all children were trying to explain their story. Then this girl, Shruti, in chaste English, then she started explaining all those things that she has been doing. And finally, that girl asked one question to our Honorable Chief Minister. Sir, do you know which village am I from? And Chief Minister said, okay, I don't know, please tell me. Sir, I am from your own native village called Chintamadka. Then Chief Minister was very curious to know further details. How about your parents? Sir, my parents used to work in your agricultural fields as laborers. Then he literally hugged her. After that, after 5 minutes of meeting, then he asked me, Praveen Kumar, get into my car. Then he, me and then two other ministers, three of us, we traveled with Chief Minister for 3 hours. So what he shared me in that journey was, shared with me in that journey was, I had never imagined, this is what it is, I had never imagined a girl from these, you know, sections, and then that too people who are working in my agricultural, working as agricultural laborers in our villages, and then their children could speak such a good English, which even corporate school children also will not be able to speak. So if education can give that much power to the most marginalized and disempowered people, I think what we should be doing under SC subplan and tribal subplan is, we must pump as much money as possible into education only, nothing else. That's what he said. And that is the reason why Telangana government is going to spend 17,000 crores in the next 5 years in education sector. That is a promise our Chief Minister has made under KG2PG mission. See, it is not the data that we give as researchers to the politicians. It is the anecdotal evidence that makes a lot of difference for the politicians. So today, it is because of these experiences, it is because of the good work that has been done by various departments, particularly the social welfare. Today, we have, the Chief Minister has committed, say, 15,000 crores. We didn't have even many schools in minority, only 12 schools in minority. Today, in minority, we have 194 schools. Nowhere in the country these many residential schools are there for minorities. Nowhere in the country these many residential schools are there, that too in English medium, my dear friends, English medium. Okay, next please. So most of the girls used to get married off after 12th grade. So we wanted to break that cycle, and then we requested our Chief Minister to do something for these girls. And then we went with a proposal of 17 degree colleges, and then we got 52 degree colleges for girls, my dear friends. All the students who were earlier used to get married, now today they are being graduated in social welfare residential degree colleges. So that is the change that we could bring. And Telangana is the only state where we have social welfare residential degree colleges for women. That is the change that our success could bring. So today we have about 10,000 students who would have otherwise become brides. in their villages are studying in our colleges. Next, please. So this is the infrastructure. Naturally, when you see government schools, you see only rickety schools, then impoverished environment, and then a lot of despondency. But you can see the infrastructure that we have been able to create in Telangana. See the color schemes. And for your information, these color schemes are designed by the students themselves, not by architects. The former students of these colleges, they have designed the color schemes. It's not us. It doesn't look like a government school at all. So that is what we have been doing. Yeah, next. But all is not well. I'm not painting a very rosy picture about our schools. Next, please. See the girl. This girl is Jyoti. And she's from a Lambada community, from Nalgonda Dindi place. And then, she got athletic medal in silver medal in national young athletic champion, games in Goa, one of the prestigious games. So in that, she got silver medal and she comes back and we felicitate her. In summer vacation, she goes to home and she doesn't come back. Ninth grader, my dear friends, 13 years. And we get really, because she's one of the jewels of our society. So we had sent a team of teachers and then only to find Mangal Sutram around her neck. The medal was replaced by Mangal Sutram. This is the tragedy of the girls in our society. So this girl, we fought vehemently with her father, and then police officers also got involved. Then we really worked very hard. So this is the tragedy of this girl. So we have a lot of girls who are facing that danger. They won't tell, but that is a tragedy. So we wanted to change the way we function after this incident. So yeah, good. So then we started a program called Quest. In every vacation, we send hundreds and hundreds of our teachers to the villages where our children are studying, only to tell them the opportunities that government is able to give, and not to get them married off to someone who is disproportionately ill-educated. So this is the Quest program. So this is happening in full steam in all our schools. And this is one of our principles. Yeah, next please. And because of our successes, government also got motivated. This is how, the adage says, success breeds success. And then success brings a lot of, funding. Then success brings a lot of attention and a lot of, Bonhomie. So earlier, our children used to sleep on the ground. And no basic minimum facilities. But today, Telangana has pumped so much of money. Today, we have all schools equipped with full-scale dormitories. And not only that, we have given cots to our girls. Not only that, we had so much of money being saved. So we requested the government to give permission to buy beds and pillows for these children, mattresses and pillows. And then today, all our students are happily sleeping on these mattresses and dreaming about their future. When you go back to their homes, there is nothing, my dear friends. Old saris stitched together and then to make them as, foam beds. This is the foam bed of, poor people. But today, we don't want those children to suffer the same poverty in our school. So we have pumped so much of money. Yeah, next. And thanks to our CM and the government, they have increased our diet charges, and then today this is the kind of food we are able to give to the students. Earlier the stereotype is social welfare hostels, you have all warm infested food they get, but those days are gone, and government is giving the best possible rice and best possible menu that children, even the university students also cannot afford this kind of food. We give mutton and chicken. We got the menu designed with National Institute of Nutrition, and all 2.9 lakh children in Telangana are going to get the same kind of food. And mind you, by 2021, there will be 8.3 lakh children will be enjoying these facilities under KG2PG mission. So that is the dream with which we are all working in the government societies. Yeah, next please. So these are the kinds of schools we are designing for the children. You can see. It looks like a very good engineering or very good college. So, and these buildings are designed by our own students who have become architects, not from others. The people who slept on footpaths, to make both the ends meet, to have some shelter, and then joined a Bachelor of Fine Arts, and then joined architecture. Those students came back and then designed these schools. We have not hired any top-notch professionals. They are the buildings designed by our own students. Next, please. And in summer, most of our students used to go and then get, get bored, or some people used to get married off, and some people used to get, die in accidents. And now, to break all those cycles, we started something called Summer Samurai. In Summer Samurai, we train all the children. Like every year, we train about 30 to 40,000 students in summer camps. So these camps are in different themes, like swimming, then movie making, and whatnot, everything. I'll show you the photographs. Yeah. Next. See, we train the students even in horse riding. Just go to North India, then you have in places like Rajasthan, if a person from marginalized or untouchable community, if he or she, not she, but if he rides a, horse, definitely he will be stoned. We have had so many incidents of that kind of, abuse. But we deliberately wanted to teach horse riding to our children, particularly girls, because we believe that the people who can tame horses, they can tame any adversity in their lives. So that is the belief with which we are training our students. So we teach horse riding, we teach music. Music is one industry where these people have been historically neglected, then they were prevented to enter that domain. Today, we are proud to say that we have a social welfare residential school for fine arts. We grab children at a very young age, at fifth grade or fourth grade, and then we are training them as the best possible musicians in Western classical, Indian classical, whatnot, everything. So then we teach them swimming, next. And we follow a cascading model. We are trying to, as a matter of principle, we are trying to reduce the dependence of children on teachers. Not to disrespect teachers. We still value the teachers. But we are trying to reduce the dependence of our students on teachers. And these are the not regular trainees. These are the trainers. These are the girls who are being groomed as trainers so that they can go back to their schools and train their sisters in unarmed combat. They can go back to their localities and train their moms and sisters in unarmed combat. That is the faith with which we are training these children. And this is one of the most successful programs in our society. This is what we call as Earn While You Learn. Next, please. And we are helping the children to make movies, because Bollywood and Tollywood, all these film industries, not open to everyone. Very few families manage this. But today, one of the movies that are produced by these children is selected for International Film Festival. The name of the movie is Dost. And our screenplay, direction, everything is done by the students. And then we train them in hospitality industry. And we train them in shooting. Yeah, next. So, and this is Sachin Sailor. I must thank Shanta Sina ma'am and then Suhim Sheikh. So they literally, not nudging, they literally forced me so to send the children for sailing. Because sailing is not a common man's game, and then you need to have, at least you need to have a boat, and then you need to have, access to sailing. But thanks to these two great people, they have taken about 10 to 15 students. Now this batch, they are taking about 30. And they are training them as sailors. And Hyderabad is not a place to have water bodies. And then generally people think sailing is done in only the coastal lines. But today, thanks to Suhim and his team, this boy emerged as the silver medalist in International Regatta Championship in Bay of Bengal. Silver medalist. And his father is a helper in a hotel. Father is a helper in hotel. And see here, the Sachin, same Sachin, he was selected for Indian Navy School. And he's one among the four students from a society who was selected for Indian Navy School. And this boy is greeting our Defense Minister, Srimati Nirmala Sitaraman. See what a honor. Where is Sachin? Where is helper? Where is hotel? And where is Bay of Bengal? And then where is Nirmala Sitaraman? And see the interaction. That is the kind of exposure we are able to give in our schools. Next, please. And this girl is Laya. Laya's father is again a farm worker. And today she is a chess champion in our schools. And then she's also got some status. I don't know what exactly the status. And this boy is Sundar Raj. He got international silver medal in international yoga championship in Kuala Lumpur. When we went to his home to announce this news, their parents ran away. Because we didn't know his home, and then we took the help of one policeman in Itkala police station. When policemen in uniform went, they ran away from backyard. Because they don't have, they got really scared. What happens? Policeman came, what did our Sundar Raj do and all that? Then finally, we could hold them and then say, it's not, you have done some wrong thing. Your son has done a great thing. And to see his home, there is no, you know, stove. There are only 3 stones on which they put some, you know, vessel and then cook food. And if it rains, it will be through and through. There is no proper roof. But today, Sundar Raj is an icon in our society, like Purna, like Anand. And this is Paulson. There may be so many, you know, people, but I'm just telling you, there are a lot of people, but this is a cricketer. And then we also invest on girl cricket. We invest heavily on women cricket, and then future Mithali Raj, future Hanuman Singh Kaur, all these people are in making in our institutions. And then we are going to start Women Cricket Academy in the next month. So, next. And I'll just tell two to three things. We don't give gifts to our students when they do well. We give only money. And money, that too in the form of checks. Even if it is 100 rupees also, we give money. We give books, but besides that, we make it a point that we give money to these children. And we have a program called Earn While You Learn. All these students, they go to live television studio and then they teach entire state of Telangana in live television. And for every 1 hour, they get 1,500 rupees. Every 1 hour, we pay them 1,500 rupees. This is called as Earn While You Learn program. And a lot of people, Ranjani and all these, Sharma and all these people who have helped us in this journey are here. So, for example, we have an interesting scheme called E Plus Club. We don't go to any trainer to learn English. This is another beautiful thing in our society. Thanks to Geet and Hindu, Mr. Srinivas Reddy. So, we started something called E Plus Club. E Plus Club is very simple. At 4 p.m., we close all the doors and windows. And we ask the students to make as many mistakes by speaking English. And whoever makes more mistakes, he or she will be rewarded. And see the magic. Within 4 years, our children are much better than many, you know, teachers in our schools. And that is the confidence with which our students are managing. And, you know, 10% of our teachers, not 10%, 500 of our teachers are on strike. But we were really worried. But our students said, don't worry, sir. Even if ma'ams do not come also, we will manage ourselves. And this is the confidence. Okay, next. So we are not way behind, digitization. We have tab-based instruction also, just an example. So we are investing heavily into technology. But to give you a glimpse of what we are able to do in this. Yeah, next. So because of the saturation, message saturation, because of the positive stereotyping, today you see this home. This girl is Narsana. She is one among the 62 students who made it to Ajim Premji University in open competition. See her home. And I met them in Ajim Premji University. I met Ajim Premji also. He literally hugged me, my dear friends. Mr. Praveen Kumar, I never imagined that children from such a marginalized background, and then they could do so well, and they're much better than those people who are from privileged classes. They're busy in drinking. They're busy in smoking and whatnot. But these children, they know the value of time. They know the value of opportunity. This is what I'm going to talk on this. This is Narsana, yeah. And this is Anand, son of agricultural laborers. Venkat Reddy might be knowing about Anand. So Anand is a student of Ibrahim Patnam School. And Anand, now he is a proud boy to have Harvard in his CV. Not many of us can get Harvard in their CVs, my dear friend. A son of a village laborers, he could go to one of the best universities in the world, where presidents and he participated in the summer program of Harvard. So they have interviewed 2,500 people in entire West Asia, then India, then South Asia for summer program. And 40 people were selected from entire these continents, and Anand was one among them. That is the power of opportunity. And today, He is one of the few students who got into that program, Harvard Summer Crossroads program. So he can proudly write that he has participated in Harvard program. Next, please. So this is Sushma, Dana is a daring girl. She's an orphan, by the way. Darshanala Sushma. She's studying in St. Francis, thanks to Anita Ramchandran and Yadadri Collector. So this girl, she was selected by US Consulate Hyderabad for Community College Initiative Program. So this girl goes to the US, and then she was allotted to Arizona State, and then she saves all the money only for one thing, that is skydiving, and second, to buy a computer. So she, one day she messages me, says, "JBM sir, I'm going to dive from the sky." I was really shaken. So finally she said, anyway, after skydiving, this is her image on skydiving. So she came back safely, and then this is the Indian flag which she's sporting proudly. So then she came back, and when she came back, she came with a computer, laptop computer. Then it was a packed thing. She entered into my office, and then she wanted to give that computer to me. Then, "Sushma, are you gone crazy? So you should have that computer, not me." You know what Sushma said? "Sir, when we went there to US, you asked our minister, you requested our minister, and then arranged the computers for us. But not everyone would be as fortunate as we are. So we saved all the money, and then we bought a computer for those children who might go in the next batch to the US. This is my payback to the society." Imagine an orphan girl who do not have parents. She used to call me on and off, "Sir, I'm remembering my mom, but I don't know whom to speak to. That's why I'm calling you." So this same girl, if I were to be in her place, I would have bought a goggle, then I would have bought a blazer, then I would have bought nice sneakers, and then watches, and then whatnot, everything. But today, Sushma did not come with those things. She came with a laptop computer, only to be given to those people who may not have that kind of opportunity. That is the power of payback. So this is Sushma, then next. And we have Siddharth. Now he's thanks to US Consulate, Salil and Joe are here. So thanks to US Consulate, so we have a lot of people going to US at a very young age, ninth graders, eighth graders, going to the US exchange program. Yeah, next please. So many of you might think that we are only good in outdoor activities. No, even academics also. From one school, this time, we had sent 52 people into MBBS, my dear friends. 52 people into MBBS in one school. Of them, 12 people joined MBBS in open competition. Not all of them are from privileged sections. All of them are from the poorest of the poor communities. And then in the last 3 years, we had sent 48 people to IITs. 133 people into NITs. And this year, I'm very proud to say that we had sent 12 people into Delhi University. Getting into Delhi University is maddeningly difficult because you need to have 95% and above. It's not very easy. Our people are sitting in those classrooms where Arun Jaitley used to sit. Our people are studying in the same schools where Subramanian Swamy, who came to Manthan on the other side of the building, where Subramanian Swamy is there. People are in Miranda House. In Delhi, people would brand on the fetus that my daughter would go to Miranda House only. My daughter would go to Lady Shriram College only. But our children, they didn't have even a single penny to board the train when they have to go to place. Thanks to Sveros Network, we could raise 7 lakhs within 1 hour from our salaries, and then we gave to those children. Go and enjoy. We have done our thing. Then future belongs to you, must go. This is what Maharaja of Baroda had done to Dr. Ambedkar, and see what the change he has brought in this country. So this is the opportunity which I am talking about. This is the power of opportunity. It gives wings to the dreams of those people who are otherwise not privileged. Okay. So one student, after 30 years, got into Vishwa Bharati University, set up by Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore. After 30 years, she has gone to Gurudev Vishwa Shanti Niketan University. Okay, next please. So this is the last but one slide. So what has really worked was multi-pronged strategy. We did not believe that only empowering teachers will change the education. No, I don't want to believe in that. That takes generations. That takes light years. The journey will be light years. What we believe is it's a multi-pronged strategy. The empowering teachers, then empower, teachers will go and then empower the students in classrooms. That doesn't work for India. You must simultaneously empower parents. You must simultaneously empower the students. You must simultaneously empower the students so that they can go back and empower the parents. You must empower the alumni. You must empower the citizens like you and me. And then they go back to the communities. Today, what is happening to our senior citizens? They must come back to our schools. They must engage. They must don't give even a single penny to these schools. Many of us think that whenever I go to school, so when I tell my salary, probably they might ask my money. They might ask for a loan. No. So far, I used to tell my salary is 1,80,000 rupees. Not even a single child has asked me, sir, please give me 100 rupees. No way. Poor people are very conscious about these things. So what they want is, how could you become like this? They want to know the story. The greatest favor any senior citizen or any person, not senior citizen, any citizen for that matter, can do for this nation's education system is to unpack your story. Very cost effective. Very cost effective. Tell your story. That is enough. That will fire up the imagination. That is not happening, unfortunately. So, there are many reasons, but I don't want to go into that. But this is what, the many things that have worked. Yeah. Next. Yeah. So, we have been able to cover only 10% of student population. But inspired by our experiments, all the neighboring villages in our schools, they started behaving as if they're residential school students, although they do not get into our schools. This is called as, a domino effect. They're learning from the ecosystem. Slowly, 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 that contagion. The contagion is happening in our schools, so around our schools, and then this is how children are doing what their colleagues, the fortunate colleagues are doing in residential schools. Yeah. So we also start Ambedkar Vigyan Mandirs in all the schools, and then we don't take even a single penny from government institutions. So we take the dilapidated buildings with the government or private, and then we repair them with all our money. It's part of a community service, and it is mandatory. It's a sense of paying back. And then we teach them only, we donate only books, and then we ask them to read the books. So this is a very important part of Sveros network. Yeah. And thanks to all the hard work of our teachers and the students, we got the first ever Telangana Excellence Award in 2017. And I am receiving, not as Praveen Kumar, as a representative of all 2 lakh children and their parents. So this is the first ever Telangana Excellence Award. Yeah. Now let me come back to the last point. I showed a black and white picture of a lady called Premamma. She is none other than my mother. So Premamma was a child laborer in 1950s. 2 teachers went to her home when she was young, searching for an accommodation. And those 2 teachers, in those days India was much more feudal. So those 2 teachers were denied accommodation in the center of the village, although they were very educated, very well educated. So they had no other way but to go to SC colony and then ask them, can you please share some accommodation? My grandfather, he was Devanna. He was super smart for his time. He was super smart. He said, okay, we have a small hut. If you don't mind, you can stay in our hut. We can share some space for you. We can spare some space for you. So that's how they started staying in a hut. And then they saw one young girl holding sickle and then going for coolie along with my grandparents. And they convinced my grandparents, our duty is to rescue these children and then send them to school, because government school is there and it is only school available. So they convinced my grandparents, and then my grandparents gave my mother an opportunity to go with the students, to go with the teachers. These 2 teachers, they made sure that my mother crosses 7th grade, and later they gave another opportunity to my mom to join a teacher training institute, boarding school in Kurnool. And from there, she goes to a teacher training institute, and since she becomes a teacher. And after that, my mother gave me an opportunity when I wanted to leave my village. So from Mahabubnagar, there were no facilities in the village where I was studying. So my mother gave me an opportunity, my mother and father, but particularly my mom. So she gave me an opportunity to come to an urban area and stay in social welfare hostel. And then from there, my teachers gave me an opportunity, particularly Dr. M.N. Reddy, from Andhra Pradesh Shakti Krishna University, and Ashirvadamma and Padmavati. So these people gave me an opportunity and then helped me to work hard to become an IPS officer, right? When I was a child, I used to cry for 1 rupee when my mom used to, come to see me in social welfare hostel, because my college mates used to get about 10 to 15 rupees as pocket money. I used to get only 1 rupee. And many people used to wear bata sandals. In those days, they were very popular. And then I used to get only Hawaii chappal. I used to cry. My mom used to say, beta, tum ek hi beta nahi hai mere liye. Char uncles bhi mai palna hai, so I have to take care of 4 uncles and 3 other children. So, father and I, it's very difficult for me. So, that was the time. But today, thanks to the opportunity, thanks to Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, thanks to the government policies, thanks to my professors, today, last year I had signed the check worth 29 crores 74 lakhs. That was the value of the check I had signed. I had tears in my eyes when I was signing the check. This is the power of opportunity. Those of you who are here, wherever you are working, whatever you do, try to give this opportunity to those people who deeply believe that their life is gone, fate accomplished. Their life is gone, closed chapter. For those people, there could be servant maids in the locality, there could be our own neighbors, or there could be your drivers, or there could be security guards in your apartments complex, or there could be anyone. Just look at those people and then try to give them an opportunity. This is what my parents did to me. This is what today, government of Telangana gave me an opportunity to serve as many children as possible. I feel so grateful, so blessed to serve these many poor souls who are economically might be poor, but they are absolutely fantastic human beings, my dear friends. So this is the story. What I deeply believe is my story can be everybody's story. My story can be your story. My story can be the story of those 8 lakh children. They're 8 lakh children. What I am trying to do in social welfare today is to just transplant that story. So, and this is our family of, 1,60,000 kids in our social. Somebody asked me, how many children do you have? I said, 1,60,000, 2 children. I have 2 children. So this big is our family. So my wife is also here. She has been supporting me all through my, journey. So she used to take care of her children. So that is the power of opportunity. And then today, I'm so happy that, So this is what we have been able to do, in the last 5 years. And this is one of the best times, the best phases of my life. And then this, any one of you can have the same phase. My only request to you is that try to get out of your comfort zone. And I always remember one phrase. With this, I close. I'll always remember one, phrase, one famous saying given by Rabbi Hillel. There are 4 sentences in this. This is, I always ask this question. If I am only for myself, I repeat, if I am only for myself, what am I? If I am not for myself, who will be? If I am not for myself, who will be? If not me, who? If not me, who? And if not now, when? If not now, when? Thank you so very much. You have been an amazing and very patient audience. Thank you so much, Ajayji. Thank you so much, everyone. I wish you all the best. And then all of us, let's make the world a better place. Thank you so very much.
Your tone and your timber and your energy is palpable, and it was vibrating. The entire audience and me was enthralled. First thing is, you have done wonderful thing. That is a small word to praise. But can we include some kind of skills training from the early age so that they can be self-dependent and could you also include some entrepreneurial development kind of a thing from early on, so that they would also become employment creators rather than job seekers? So their social esteem, their social, all the things will go up, and they would be as good as any other community. It need not be employment seeker. That was one of my observations. Thank you so much.
Absolutely, sir. But only one thing I want to be slightly cautious about is the skills. I think they should be introduced at an appropriate age. Children deserve some time to play. I think they have to play. Otherwise, I think nowadays, because of this skilling thing, now people are like, we have already going through the process of IITs and NITs and then medicine, and then even the fetuses are being branded that my daughter or the son will be IIT or NIT, all that kind of stuff. So I am only worried that tomorrow skilling should not become another IIT stuff. So the moment a child is born, suddenly parents would say, okay, his hands have to be dexterous, then it should hold the spanners, all that stuff. I think till 7th or 8th grade or some appropriate age, children should be allowed to play. After that, slowly the skilling concept has to be introduced. I fully agree with you. And this there is a kind of emergency in terms of skilling. But at the same time, we should allow the children to play. Yeah, that's what. Yes, sir.
Jai Bhim. I am a doctor running a nursing home,
sir.
25 beds at Gandhinagar.
Yes,
for the last 46 years, I am a practitioner.
Yes, sir.
I am an Ambedkarite. Now you have taken the cause of vulnerable people's education.
Yes, sir.
Children's education. Apart this, according to Dr. Ambedkar, if a society wants to come up, it has to go through the three cardinal principles.
Yes.
That is, educate the society, agitate for your rights, then organize the society. So out of these cardinal principles, you have taken one principle concretely. In future, what are the other two steps, how you are going to organize in your life, and what are the things you are going to give to the society in future? Thank you.
It's a good question, but right now I don't have such a longer perspective, but I continue to contribute to the education of the most needy children, not necessarily only SCs and STs, but all those needy children who have been denied the benefit of good education. And second thing I'm going to do is I want to liberate them from dependence. This is my goal. I don't want them to be dependent on anyone. You can see our commandments. You have that in you. When Purna went to Mount Everest, or when Dr. B. R. went to Columbia University, or when Anand Kumar said this thing, and when Srivita scaled Mount Everest, or when Sachin, when he got the silver medal in regatta, they were not excessively dependent on anyone. They were only trying to discover the potential, and then they were making their energy. Then all we need is to encourage, find out those characters, and then find out those energies, and then try to harness them in a proper way. And then that I will be doing. So at the same time, I don't want this dependence, and I am anti-sympathy. So the more you show sympathy, the more you do damage to any child, sir, for that. Want them to discover their potential. So this is what I'm going to do. I don't have the goal other than this. Yeah, next.
Sir, I am Ratan Kumar, assistant professor in Government Degree College.
Yes, sir.
Whatever you have shown, I regularly use to face those things.
Yes.
I regularly see the empowerment in the poor people.
Mm.
Let me tell you, in our college, out of 150 students, only one OC is there. Remaining are BC, SC, STs. I think this is the reason why most of the governments for decades neglected the government educational initiatives. I feel it has been done intentionally. That's why I'm telling. And I think talent is coming through the infrastructure development. Why people has not been doing like Arvind Kejriwal or some other people where they have allocated majority funds in their GDP? Why till now that didn't happen?
Sir, it's a very interesting question, and I appreciate your views. And it is not for me to solve all the problems, but people like you, you should try to take care of these issues, and then you should bring them to the notice of the government. And then let me tell you, if they are presented in a proper way, governments are not going to keep quiet. Their government are going to, otherwise why would I get? See, my budget, when we started our journey, my budget was the 370 crores. Today, my budget is 1,256 crores.
12,000.
How did it happen?
12,000.
No, no. My organization, but in future, it will be, within next 5 years, it's going to be 15,000 crores. Then why government is committing this much? Because we could present our case. We could present our case properly. And people like you, you should work on this aspect. And then you should come with the proposals. Now, no amount of, OCs are not studying, only SCs and BCs, but this is a wonderful opportunity for you to, fight for their cause and then bring those problems to the notice of those people who can listen. And then I don't think government is bereft of such people. So right. You try that, and then we will, in fact, we will help you, or Sveros Network.
Right.
Hello.
Venkat Ramna, Dr. Praveen.
Yes, sir.
I want to bring in three things. Yes. Number one, the first two people can be game changers, which you told, right? The Purna and Anand. That's the first thing which I understand. And Mr. Shankaran, S.P. Shankaran, who has been instrumental.
S.R. Shankaran.
S.R. Shankaran. I'm sorry. Now, I want to make this audience aware. We watch commercial movies. Purna is one movie where the tax was given free.
Yes.
And 10% of the crowd was there, and children were hardly there. Dr. Praveen, I would ask you to see that this movie is shown to every school in the country, not just in the particular state.
Yes.
This is my humble request. Then second one is the root. I'm an anthropologist from Delhi University. When we look at the root, when we go back to our root, we find again that. So what can we do to uplift the parents? Which in turn, as you were telling, when the police went, they ran away.
Yes.
Yes or no?
That's
and
true.
And today, when we go, they will tie the knot rather than sending them to school or college. So it is important to bring the attitudinal change by the teachers to the parents and uplift them.
I this totally is, agree with you, sir. I
this
totally
is what
agree.
Exactly the enlightened intellectual this thing. Thank you very much.
Point
right?
Very well said. I totally agree with you. And then I'm extremely happy to share with you, sir. Every quarter, once we take the most successful alumni, particularly the woman, and we take to parents, and all the parents would converge at plain place, and then request alumni to come in their choicest dress and in their cars and then motorcycles, whatever. We request them to narrate their own story so that the hope can be marketed, the hope can be showcased. So that it sinks into their brains. When they decide, even by conforming to their own neighborhood norms, when they decide to marry their daughter to disproportionately ill-educated, they must get the image of success before they take the decision. So this has paid very rich dividends, sir. And this is our third successful campaign of parenting ambassadors. So we are creating thousands of parenting ambassadors in our journey. And this is just a glimpse of what we do. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. This is a wonderful question you have asked.
Excuse me, sir. I'm running a Facebook group for exclusively for mathematics teachers. Mm. And I'm finding it very difficult to get them to participate. And I hope for something proactive stance from you. There are about 500 to 1,000 members, and all others are participating, like professors from IIT and higher education. But I want somebody from the actual teaching community to participate. kindly do something about it.
Definitely, sir. I'll kindly get in touch. Give me your card. Then
sure,
I'll be
sure, sir. Thank
extremely
you,
happy to. Raju.
So I'm Jayashree Ramdas from.
Ma'am, I know you. Thank you so much. Let me tell you about Jayashree Ramdas, ma'am. And then she literally forced me to send her children to Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. And then I was. Now, they used to only hear about electron microscope, but today, thanks to Dr. Jayashree, and most of our marginalized children are able to touch electron microscope. So, ma'am, yes, ma'am.
So, we have an outreach program. Our campus, it's a new campus of TIFR at Hyderabad near Gopanpalli. And we have been working with four of the schools which are in our neighborhood. One thing that I would like to say that we were very surprised to see in these schools because we thought they're for SCST children and marginalized and so on. But the kind of confidence that you see in the girls, girl students particularly, and the boys students also, in girl students you don't expect to see it. They're very curious and they first, question you. So they ask you, where have you come from? Why have you come here? Are you getting a degree from this? Are you doing some social work? How did you get to this institute? What kind of exam did you give? So, we have to face all these questions from the kids. And it's really a pleasure to see children who are, so self-assertive and so curious. On the other hand, I'd like to say something that, you see in all other schools also, so this is not particular to social welfare schools, but students are too passive and accepting of just, what is told to them or what is in their textbooks. So questioning of what they learn is very, very much missing, and therefore a sort of active engagement in learning is missing, and it is completely theoretical, practical knowledge because it is not there in the competitive exams. So therefore, experiments and laboratories are very highly neglected. And that's something which we are trying to develop in the social welfare schools. But I think this is something that every parent, teacher should think of, that what their children are going through in their education. Is it making them passive and accepting and just learning by rote? Are they really becoming thinking, independent human beings? And I hope that our social welfare students will become active.
We will
and
try, ma'am, with the help
beings.
Of people yeah. like you. So another thing I wanted to tell you is, like, ma'am, you have just raised a very important point. So role modeling. So what kind of role models, what kind of mentors you introduce to children? Like in the absence of parental control, we had so many role models in our vicinity who used to drink beers. So we thought drinking beer as a student, because you're getting a stipend anyway in all agriculture university, we started drinking beers. But it took 7 to 8 years to realize that, this is not going to take us anywhere, closer to success. Same is the case with smoking. So if my father used to smoke, and then I never used to realize that, smoking is not a bad thing. So, but only after you have that maturity, suddenly you realize that, smoking is a, bad thing. So I used to aspire to become, lorry driver. Not that lorry driver as a profession is bad. What I'm trying to say, I may have had more potential to dream about many good things. But today, I'm an IPS officer. I won't say that I'm an IPS officer by a conscious choice. It is because all my colleagues were preparing for civil services. So I thought preparing for a civil services probably is a good thing. If not this service, some other service I would get into and get a good life. I'm being very honest. But not as a civil services as a choice, and then I had a vision of a bureaucrat and all that. No. Today, ma'am, we are trying to show our children what are the choices make. If you want to become a dancer, we will show you a dancer, Anand Jayashankar. So, or you, if you want to become a painter, then go to Stanley Suresh. I'm just telling an example. So, go to Ravi Reddy. So, we are trying to encourage, if you want to become a scientist, go to Dr. Jayashree Ramchandra or Ramdas or Jayashree Subramanyam. So, like that, we are trying to encourage people to choose different professors irrespective of their socioeconomic background. So, that is what we are trying to do. Yeah.
No, I'm Dinesh. I just want to ask you that, you are doing a good job in the social welfare residential schools, but how about the other government schools which are there in the districts of Telangana? You said they are having a domino effect, but how the education system is going to be improved in this particular school?
It is improving, sir, but not at the pace like social welfare, for obvious reasons. Because social welfare residential school, children, they stay with us. They don't go back to their homes. Then they stay with us for 220 days. And all our teachers, they play the role of parent. And in government schools, they come at 9 a.m. and then they leave at 4 p.m. perhaps. So after that, what happens? The government teacher do not have any control. So this is one of the most important reasons. Of course, there are a lot of other practices social welfare residential schools do. And I think now things are getting better. And then we are slowly, government also is slowly trying to bring the turnaround. And then let's hope for the best.
Yeah.
Sir, my name is Prithvi. Sir, I'm a civil aspirant. Yes. I wanted to join police services.
Yes.
So, is it true that we cannot avoid taking bribe all the time, and there are some situations that we are forced to due to some grave danger? Is that true?
What an innocent question. There is no situation where you are forced to take bribe. I so far in my 22 years of service, I have not come across where I was forced to take bribe. No way. No. Taking bribe is your personal choice. You should know the risk that you are running. I repeat, taking bribe is your personal choice, but it is immoral. And it is illegal. It is illegal and immoral. First, you must ask the immoral, moral question. Then comes the legal. Not the legal first and then moral next. First, am I supposed to take this or not? Once you pass the test, then you take it. But 100%, not 99, 100% we fail that test. Taking bribe is not a matter of right or compulsion. No, not at all. So, no situation in not only bureaucracy, any place, no situation will force you to take a bribe. You go according to the rule book to the extent possible. And even if you can't play according to the rule book, still there are 100 solutions where you don't have to take bribe, still help the poor people. That's what we have been able to do. So what matters in bureaucracy is the intention, not the authority. It is not the position that you occupy. It is the direction towards which you want to go. It is not the position. It is not the technical authority that will help you. It is the informal authority you extend as a human being over the large population, not the rule books. Intention. Intentions are very important. What kind of intentions you have? That will help you. So never feel that you are forced to take bribe. No situation will force you. No person will force you.
Sir, today some of the greatest hope of the nation is that some of the brightest minds of India are taking education as their choice. And here in Telangana and Telugu states, you are a big inspiration for many of the youngsters to choose education as their career option. And sir, I have two questions for you, sir. Sir, you entered social welfare homes as an individual and you built that institution on your shoulders. Sir, if you see the entire India as such, after 1986, right now there is an exercise for changing education policies that is going on. Regarding the new policy, heard of you for the policy. So I just want to ask at what level the inputs are being taken. And apart from that, sir, your case is a classic example of leadership. What a committed leadership can bring. So in the case of school also, I wish to see every school principal with as much vigor and passion as you have. So what are the exercises that you have taken to build that school leadership, which is vital for the outcomes?
Very good question. I'll answer second question in the shortest possible format, and then I'll come to the first question. So first question is, thanks for calling me as a leader, but I manage the things by working around. And preparing a generation of leaders is not like, kind of feeding data and then asking for an output. It is a very organic and a very gradual process, because you have to deal with the human beings. And human beings come with their own payloads of experience, and then payloads of misconceptions, and payloads of other prejudices. So when we talk to them, the best way of transforming people is to live by example. So if you do this, and if you become punctual, they will become punctual. If you read books and then come to the classroom, they'll also read and come to the classroom. So, and it takes time. So you have to be impatient and patient. You have to be impatient to make the change. At the same time, you have to be patient to see the change. If you are impatient to see the change, then there will be, trauma on the ground. So they will be really traumatic. So they don't digest that, and then there will be revulsion. So then, for coming to first question, policy. See, I strongly believe you can make wonderful policies. You can have glassy brochures, and then have nice hoardings about the policies. But what really inspires the policymakers are the successful examples. I'm very happy to make that successful example. So policies, you have 100 policies, but if they don't work, and then if you have put examples, then so I'm leaning in favor of working on the ground rather than being a policymaker. Thank you. Yes, sir.
It's a touching story of empowerment and also opportunity.
Sir.
But how you thought of mountaineering? Why not something else? KCR must have given lots of money. That is different. But it is because of you, the government decided to spend that money.
Yes, sir.
That's a great job.
Sir, mountaineering, not because it is easy. It is an extremely risky expedition. But that really challenges all faculties of your body, including your mind. So whenever I visited a lot of schools, I found our children have tremendous energy in those faculties. Other than cognitive ones, they have a lot of other great energy. Then I thought nobody had tapped those energies before. I thought I should give vent for those pent up anger for not giving them an opportunity. So that's why I have selected mountaineering. And second thing is, like Suhaim Sheikh, we have Shekhar Babu. We need a trainer, coach who can put his heart and soul into that. Today, Sachin has become a sailor, not because Sachin is a born sailor. No, it is because his guru, Suhaim Sheikh, he left his IIT and everything. He left his job, and then he's putting all he has in sailing. Shekhar Babu is the same guy. Shekhar Babu, he left everything. He wanted to make children, he wanted to bring climbers out of the children. And to make change, sir, I cannot scale Mount Everest. Probably I can go up to base camp. But what as a leader, what as a manager, what I should be doing, I should be strengthening hands of those children who want to realize their dreams. I can give wings to the dreams. I can become a wing. I can become a wind to the wings of those people who want to dream. I can strengthen the hands. So that's what I can do, and then I use that all opportunity. So,
Hello, ma'am. Sir. A very inspirational story. Congratulations.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
I work for an NGO which works for the welfare of hearing impaired children. And apart from the many things that we do, screening children, giving them, helping them with surgeries and hearing aids and all that, one of our programs is to help prevent cases of hearing impairment. And one thing that we have noticed is that most children suffer from this impairment because of being products of consanguineous marriages. And as you must very well know, this is rampant in our, both the Telugu states and most, since you seem to have that reach and the kind of, we in our organization, we try to reach out. Whenever we find a platform, we try to spread this awareness. So through you, I would like, because you seem to be helping to prevent child marriages. In the same manner, if you could also help to prevent this kind of, you tell them the problems of inbreeding and, you know, marrying sure. within the family, it would be really very
absolutely,
good.
Absolutely,
with the kind of reach that you have.
In a Swero ideology, we discourage this kind of inbreeding, ma'am. Well, A. B. And all our marriages are dowry-free marriages. And we don't take dowry. And even if someone takes dowry out of ignorance or out of greed, once he realizes, he must give dowry back in equal monthly installments into his in-laws. So we have that scheme also. EMI for paying dowry vapsi. Yeah.
What are the current interest rates?
So my name is Babu. Just wondering, considering that superstition is one of the biggest emergencies the country is facing, considering that the most dangerous superstitions make victims of the families of the Swairo members, do you have critical education component, scientific temper development, anti-superstition programs for your children and for their teachers?
Babu Garu, we have realized this very early on, and we encourage all our children in a very modest way. We have started, and then now we are at a very good way. So in our classrooms also, we encourage children to go through the content at least 2 to 3 days in advance and come to the classroom and then start debating on the content that is thrown at them. This we call it as flipping, and flipping is a very popular concept in Western societies, but here we started, this is first year of flipping, and then we are very happy about it. Second thing is, we have partnered with a lot of rational organizations, and then every month, three times, they come, they not only train our children, but more than that, they train our parents in summer. In summer, we have rational thinking campaign for parents. This summer, we could train about 5,000 parents, and then we are training them as ambassadors. We are not against any religion. We are not against any faith. But we want our people to be critical thinkers. Point well taken, sir. Thanks for reminding.
I am a regular person who attends Manthan, every Manthan lecture almost.
Ma'am.
There is a sort of partisan attitude, I'm sorry to say, where I have to beg for my opportunity to comment or make my remark. So anyway, I really enjoyed your lecture.
Thank you, ma'am.
I am Bhavna Chari. I am a poet and writer by profession.
Thank you, ma'am.
And I just want to make a remark. As we say, failures are stepping stones to success.
Yes, ma'am.
So there are plenty, of course, there are plenty and ample opportunities which come in the way. And this thing is to cash in and capitalize on that opportunity to strive for success. And through proper guidance and support, these children can work wonders. They can achieve what they want, and they can secure their endeavors. They can accomplish themselves, and they have formidable strength and potential within them. It is for the elders or senior citizens, as we say, to, you know, encourage them, and then in proper guidance and proper support, which could bring them more laurels and make them flower beautifully late, you know, for the future as citizens of our country. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for your remarks.
Good evening, sir.
Yes, sir.
It goes beyond doubt that your passion is something which has brought this institution to this level.
Yes,
but typically we have seen in most of the government organizations who reach this level tends to fail when this leadership is shifted from this place to other place. What kind of structural administrative reforms you have put in your department which will not require Praveen to take this whole legacy forward?
Fantastic question, sir. Very good question. It talks about sustainability. Sir, very important, very relevant for not only this talk, but for entire administration. See, first thing what we did was, whatever we did from July 7th, 2012, or even the good works of our successors, predecessors, and till today, we have documented everything. So the institutional memory is being built on a very stronger platform. B, we have converted all the best practices into standing orders and the policies. C, those standing orders and policies have been converted into academic calendars. Those of you who are running educational institutions who know the importance of academic calendar and the timetables. So this is the third part. And fourth, all these academic calendars have been ratified by the Board of Governors. And these things are placed on the floor of assembly. And assembly also has acknowledged, and they are in the documents of assembly, budget documents, all these practices. Then this is not enough. I have only answered part of your question. Tomorrow, a person can come and then sit in on my chair, and then he can still do not act, and then nobody can ask him any question. So we have prepared a generation of leaders among the teachers who are immersed, who face the immersion, go through the immersion of all these success stories. So for that, we change the language that our children speak, the language that our teachers speak. If I say ignite, right from fifth grader to the degree college student, they understand. Because ignite is bringing the brilliant minds together, and then they debate for 3 days, and then they go back. If I say sports meet, they understand. If I say quest, all our teachers understand. Quest is a program where all the teachers go back to the communities and then try to learn from the communities. Then if I say impact, right from fifth grader to the degree college lecturer, so what I'm trying to say, all these best practices have become terms which have become part of our lingua franca. So they have become part of our language. Then the last part is, we have trained parents. The entire community is being trained about what is happening in the schools. Tomorrow, if any person does not want to do anything, community is going to ask that question. This is the best form of sustainability, sir. So post Praveen Kumar also, I think people will have to fall in line. Then I left Andhra Pradesh Society in 2014, but even today, Andhra Society is following the same practices that we have been able to. In some places, they have done much better, actually. So, and we are competing with each other, but on the same platform which we have created. So I think we have to be smarter when we institutionalize any innovation, sir. That is very important, very important question, sir.
Kumar,
I think
we want to test your training as a police officer. Can you answer 3 more questions?
We appreciated your speech very much, and I was really moved to tears by your story.
Thank you, ma'am.
And thank you very much. I'm sure there are many others here who felt the same way. And I'm very glad to see you. I see you as the father of 2 lakh children.
Thank you so much.
I'm so happy. I'm so happy, and thank you very much. My question here, I was a teacher myself. I was a professor of English. And my question here is, after listening to you, I found that there is a compartmentization like that. Means I did not find anything about integration. Integration in the sense that, the poor and the backward, or you call Dalit, and whatever name you call a section of the society, the name may change, but the thing will not change. You can call a rose by any other name, as Shakespeare has said. So that is not the only thing. What I'm telling is that the compartments must go. Our ultimate aim is a casteless society. And for that, these children to feel that they must be made to feel that they are part of all the other societies, other castes. So for that, in that direction, how we can lead our children, all these children, because they should not feel inferior.
Fantastic question, ma'am.
My question is in continuation to that, ma'am.
Yeah.
Actually, even I wanted to ask the same thing. Mm. We are talking about the casteless society, but the application form itself gives a column for the caste. and we are talking about minority schools, ST schools, SC schools. Don't you think the children should learn and grow together when we talk about the, when we want to see a caste-free India? And one more thing I would like to say that I see Ambedkar in you. I am working in Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University since last 11 years and I have been seeing the portrait of Ambedkar, but today I feel as if, as if I'm seeing you.
I don't, honestly, I don't deserve this.
Thank you for the inspiring
Ambedkar
evening, sir.
Ambedkar is a legend, man. So, see, it's very, ticklish to talk about cashless society and then caste-led society. So both are equally cashless India and then caste-led India. So what I'm trying to say, I think caste-less India, I would say it is a very, a good aspiration, good dream. But in the near future, I don't think we have to be extremely realistic. I don't think it is going to happen. I'm not really worried about that. But you can definitely make a caste to a greater extent irrelevant. So what really, now I'll come to your question, ma'am. So you're talking about integration. So talking about integration is really very good and very nice, and it has to be attempted. And then by design, we are attempting that. So we take all communities into our schools, but we give, because we have to help the most marginalized community who have been kept away from education for 2,000 years and then have been kept away from a lot of opportunities. So we try to make most of the children from, we try to bring most of our children from those communities, but that doesn't mean that we don't bring other children. We have other children as well. Come to our schools, we have children from all communities, and then in summers, all of us come together. And then we stay, we spend time with the other children for about 30 to 35 days, and then our children, when they go for community service, they don't go to only their colonies, they go to all other colonies as well. And then they do. So what we are trying to do, we are trying to attempting at a quantum leap. In quantum leap, the most marginalized people should get the best possible education and then should get the best possible opportunity and then should go to the best position where a privileged people also can go. So this is the best way of integration. So otherwise, in the name of integration, so we tried that also, ma'am. But in the name of integration, and then you keep the same percentage of people, and these people, the village is just replicated in the schools also. Whatever happens in the village, same thing is being replicated in the school. So we are being very careful about integration, and we are not, another important thing is, we are not promoting hatred in the minds of people, man. So we are saying that's why our first commandment says, you are not inferior to anyone. You are not inferior to anyone. Similarly, you must not hate anyone. So hatred is not promoted in our institutions at all, not at all.
Good evening, sir. I'm Gajri. I visited Bellampalli school and the
Sanganuru
campus. It
yes.
was amazing.
Yes.
But one thing I was wondering about, that where you collected these words in the wall, it's really missiles, that words. Even myself, still that words are making more and more enthusiasm. And that was, I want to know, even I never seen that kind of the words in even in a corporate schools also.
What
and
words?
The words in the wall, painting boards and everything.
Okay.
Is there any kind of children are doing or anybody is doing that?
Sir, because whatever we do in our schools, it is the collective intelligence of all our students. It is our students who come up with all these ideas. It is not my making. It is not Praveen Kumar. It is all our students and teachers. They collectively create all these words, whether it's called a Samar Samurai or Swero or whatever. Yes, last question.
Jai Bhim, sir.
Jai Bhim.
Myself, Sai Khan. I'm from Agriculture University, sir.
Yes, sir.
So I have a set of questions, sir.
Yes, sir.
I'll be quick. So what made you to make such a big impact? Did the studies at Harvard made you to come up with Swaros, or as a civil servant? That is one question, sir. The other question is, see, as a country, we are an agrarian country, and we do not talk about agriculture in our schools. So I was, fortunately, my father is an agriculture graduate. So after working as cane manager in Nizam Sugars, he took VRS and went to Kenya. So I studied third and fourth class there, sir. So it is a British type of education. So there, agriculture was one of the subjects. So where I had 1 into 1 square of meter, I had grown the sweet potato and taken it to home. So, as in India, we need agriculture as a subject. Since you are into sparrows and you are able to make policy change, so I want agriculture as a subject to be taken into school, sir.
I will answer both the questions, sir.
One more thing, sir.
You have already done two questions. Yeah.
So,
we can talk off the dais also.
This is the last question, sir.
Yes.
See, nowadays, I see youth, sir, lot, they are very greedy. So, we need value and skill-based education. So, what are the steps the governments and policymakers are taking up? So, this is what...
One minute, sir. Before you answer that question, you can answer it together with this question.
If I remember.
Yeah.
Okay. Surely, it is going to be a question, not statement. The question is, one-liner, do you think Purna deserves Bharat Ratna?
Who is it?
Who deserves Bharat Ratna?
Who?
Purna. Oh, sorry.
If you ask, if you ask Purna, I don't know whether Purna deserves Bharat Ratna or not, but if you ask Purna, she forgot that she is the youngest ever female to have scaled Mount Everest. Because she says, sir, Everest is the first step in my journey. So, sir, these awards and all, they are major distraction. Our focus is on creating a species called spheros, not the caste, not the class. We are trying to create a species which can lead the entire communities, all the marginal, cutting across all sections. So, I reserve my answer on that. And then coming back to your, I'll very simple. Harvard gives you a platform to think boldly, to meet wonderful people like you in the classrooms. Classrooms are very democratic. There is no gundagiri in the classrooms. And there is no know-all approach. I know everything and then you don't know anything approach. There is no. Even the people who cannot read and write, like one ma'am just mentioned about hearing impaired, Harvard gives more value, equal value to those people who cannot even speak. So they are not at least the Western classroom, they are not judgmental to the greater extent. There could be some exceptions, but that gives you a lot of exposure. And people, whatever idea, you might think this is a silly idea, but they say it could be a good idea. So they encourage you to, think beyond your, imposed limits. Then second thing, agriculture. I am very happy to share with you, 25% of our schools, they get their vegetables from our kitchen gardens. And children are the farmers in the kitchen gardens. So agriculture is a very integral part of our pedagogy. And then on and off, we take our children out of school and then we take them to agricultural fields and then tell them, and farming is a very important activity. And then thank you so much for all the
Thank you, everyone. I don't know about...
Thank you. Thank you so much.